Well, that actually escalated quickly. Well, Panzermeister36 did a shout out in his community tab, and yeah, this led to about 190 new subscribers showing up on my channel. Thank you both. Thank you so much. Thank you, Panzermeister36, for the shout out and promoting my channel. And thank you, all of the viewers, for subscribing to my channel, for being here watching my videos. It's a great honor to speak to so many people. I just want to say thank you. To introduce myself, my name is Kai Marcel. I'm an engineering student here from Germany, and I like to build scale models. And I focus on German scale models only, World War II. This is the main reason, because I'm interested in the manufacturing process more than the field use of them, and I can really focus down on this topic itself. Be advised that I highly oppose any ideology that went with this time area on the German side. I'm interested in the scale models and would like this channel to be a place for all of the persons, all of the people around the world, no matter where they come from or what they believe in. Now, for the build videos, the project that was scheduled last week and this week went horribly south. The model fell from the desk and was beyond any repair. I tried to make good of it and replace it with this kit. I will start this right away because you guys are really interested in some late war vehicles. I got the feedback from the comments. So yeah, let's build this King Tiger in the upcoming weeks. When the videos is are ready, I drop them just right away. Now, into today's build, I have only a rebuild prepared. This is Dragon Models Bergepanzer Tiger P. That's a conversion from the Porsche Tiger Tank series. It's recovery variant. The model kit number is down in the information box. I built this thing in its early appearance. There was a late one. I own this model too. What I would like to do is use some simple weathering techniques to get this very pale tank into a more worn appearance, keeping it simple. I would like to talk a little bit about composition when we arrange our effects. I know there are many ways out there. Much of them are more advanced than what I show, but I'm a learner still, consider myself a beginner, and I improve along the way, both the video editing, the visual storytelling, as well as my modeling skills. Enough waffle for now. So I gave this tank the usual treatment of a hull red underpainting, followed by RAL 7028 Dunkelgelb, and a brown wash to begin with. So we can dive right into the weathering process. We get kinked the S-tracks with this model kit. That's the late type, and that would be correct for a Ferdinand Bergepanzer that would been used in field. They were delivered with the newer type. The direct comparison against a full model track leaves an obvious difference, the S-tracks being too thick and missing the hollow guide horn. I have mounted the S-tracks on this vehicle before, and I don't want to use them. I think they look ugly, and I need alternatives. There are two main types of tracks. The whole Ferdinand series was equipped with the early type, and then the Elephant and the Bergepanzer Tiger P had the late type. The Bergepanzer was delivered, I think, in September 33 to the Heavy Tank Destroyer Battalion 653, and the difference is quite obvious. The late type has a rounded shape on the outside and hollow guide horns, the early version not. No hollow guide horns, flat surface with three recesses. Okay, this is some burnishing fluid. It's used to make these tracks rusty. I have used this fluid once before, and that was on the late tracks I showed earlier. Now I want to see if it can be reused or if it loses its potential. To prepare my tracks, I washed them in my ultrasonic cleaner using dish cleaner and water. I don't want to use an aggressive solvent, just getting rid of all of the oils and fats we get on there from touching the tracks or moving them around, maybe a release agent or everything else that would hinder the direct contact between this, maybe an acid, and the tracks itself. And I leave them now dry and give them a good rinse with water, let them dry again. This is the burnishing fluid itself. I'm wearing gloves and goggles, and the liquid itself is standing on top of a plastic box cover and some paper towels to soak them in if something happens. So being a little bit cautious and prepared might help. The complete rusting process takes a little bit of time. I think this fluid has lost its potential, making it quite expensive for $7 for one use. I was able to get a second use out of it. When I get a third use out of it, I'm happy with it. Time will tell. Let me come back once more to the history of this vehicle. We have a planned total of about 5 in August. 33, a total of 3 tanks were converted to this vehicle, and they were delivered in September. In September, the Ferdinand Battalions was still in Russia, and there was no evidence of the use of late type tracks on a Ferdinand vehicle itself. And this is in contrast to the Bergepanzer, was equipped with the late type of tracks up on delivery. I chose the early type because I have some references showing this vehicle being tested and trialed at the Nibelungenwerk in St. Valentin, Austria, and they clearly have the early version of tracks on them. I bought them years ago. There were quite some new books arriving here. Der andere Tiger von Michael Fröhlich, he was the author, as well as Ferdinand from the same person. So we have quite some new information about this one. The tracks are now out of the burnishing fluid, and I gave them about 2 or 3 minutes on the open air, still wet from the fluid, and they were still rusting. Then they were washed twice in soapy water and water, and you get your hands very rusty when handling them. The tracks mounted on the vehicle make a very nice impression. There's no comparison against the DS tracks, I think. Now let's start with the weathering effects. I first moisten the surface, as so many times with enamel odorless thinner, and then I would like to start faking a color modulation. What I use here is oil paint, that's a white oil brusher, and we have no affection for this company. I just use them because my local store has them and I wanted to try them out. I let this run at a higher speed, but with all in all detail, just because I want to show how well they blend or how the blending functions or works. It is not a full-blown color modulation, of course, but I think this highlighting or color modulation fake works fine enough for many vehicles and leaves more control than a airbrushed effect. Now the bottom side after the white has dried, this is a green, and dark yellow and green works quite well together because the way this dark yellow was manufactured back in the time, it was made from an ochre and black both together dive into green, so I'm faking a little bit a shadow for a green area. With all the blending done, and I have to blend a lot because the color or the paint job is really rough out down there where I couldn't sand it very well. In recessed areas, the whole thing is inverted, of course. The dark side is above and the bottom gets brighter. Now you see me applying the chipping effect. I use a whiter or brighter version of my dark yellow to get some areas affected. And what I would like to talk about with this chipping effect is where to put some chips. You have seen me a little bit struggling on the placement, the initial placement of the brighter color. Now, of course, I'm coming back with a dark brown just to add the actual color of the rusted metal underneath. And where I put the chips is where I can't attach streaks. This is the very next process on these pale open tanks, and I wanted a really heavily weathered and deteriorated tank. We have to look where we can add things so we don't overload the surface and still keep it clean, at least a little bit clean. And I'm attaching here my streaks to every hull point where we have the interleaving armor plates, and water would run down or could run down. This includes the vision port, this hatch, this small one, self-defense port, I guess, and like areas like the hooks, or just, yeah, as I said, the interleaving armor plates. And the way I apply these streaks is very controlled. I use a number one natural hair brush and the enamel odorless thinner. The product I use for the streaking is again Ammo by MIG. That's streaking for winter vehicles, I think, as well as streaking grime. And I try to get these streaks into the right shape by streaking them from the top to the bottom and trying to keep a straight line that gets narrower the more I come to the bottom of the armor plate. Yeah, this is obvious, of course, but these are things I'm, as a not highly advanced scale modeler, concern myself with. And it's so easy to get a crooked streaking effect, and this doesn't look natural, of course. And I would like to point out, when using this rust color, like here on the emphasizing of the chipping effect, you will have to do a lot of cleanup if you don't have a really good paint job underneath it. There's truly a lot of staining capabilities in these enamel paints, and yeah, just work careful or you will end up with a brown instead of a dark yellow tank. The cleanup is what you see me doing here. The surface pre-moistened, not dripping wet, just moist, helps a lot with containing the streaking effect. If you add this odorless thinner, you always add a little bit pigment that is catched in the brush, even if it's cleaned out. So you will add a stainy effect. If you look to the right on my rust streaks, you will see this half circle. That's where the odorless thinner did spread out, and if I would not come back, this would create a permanent stain. The edges of the casemate are a little bit more darkened down with an earth effect. That's another enamel product from Ammo by MIG from the Nature Effect series. And I just frame the corners, I round them out, making the impression of a little bit of accumulated dirt or grime or dust, whatever you would like to call it. And this is done with almost all of the horizontal surfaces, keeping the effects nice and simple. And I showed you only one section because I treated each section by its own. Whenever I had half an hour, 10 minutes time, I went for one or two sections. And during the week, the complete vehicle came together. There was no sitting down and doing chips for 4 hours. That would be quite boring and defile the purpose of the modeling itself. So yeah, just treating it in sections, going slow, and the complete model comes together. Now let's deal with the running gear, or to say the mud effects of the running gear. I start with an own mixture made from the Heavy Mud series from Ammo by MIG and some modeling sand together with static grass, just to add a little bit more texture. These products are a little bit a thick, non-textured or very lightly textured enamel product, and they give us plenty of time to work with. That's why I chose to use this. The color I use is pretty dark, but not glossy, so it's not a wet effect. It dries flat and should leave the impression of common dirt or ground earth. Then this is my base color, of course. So I will repeat the process with a little bit lighter and darker paint as well. For now, I'm stippling this textured mud into the areas or recesses around the drive sprocket. And yes, this is a petrol electric drive. The electric motors are in the rear, and this is why we have the drive sprocket in the back of the vehicle, what's quite uncommon for a German vehicle. I apply the mud effect to the side hull and I leave windows. This is very important from a point of composition. When we use this mud effect in a around the complete area, we have nothing this effect would contrast against, and this is why I leave an area unaffected so we can see the chassis through. The underside of the fenders are painted completely, and this cutout there in the middle, this would be the exhaust for a Ferdinand, but not on this vehicle. The small cutout in the side wall there, this is the exhaust for a Bergepanzer. And now I'm pulling down some of the mud into the previously open area, and I use a little bit enamel thinner to open it back up, just give it a little bit a blending effect. That's a quite usual and simple method of creating a little bit more effects, what things that are going on a large surface. I was given the advice to add some pigments after this, and I try it out. I'm not too happy with the result yet. I should look deeper into this. And as I said previously, I'm now applying a few different other paints, just working my way around these windows, these unaffected spaces, creating a little bit more contrast, giving it a little bit more effort. And of course, I'm working myself really into this topic more and more, since mud or the complete environment effect onto a vehicle is one of the most important things I think we can do to a tank model. Dealing with the road wheels as a separate step, I start with the basically the same mixture, but a really bright color in the center of the road wheels. I want to have a bright center, and I want like to get darker with the color the more we get to the running surface of the wheel. While applying this darker color, I try to not affect the metal looking edge of the running surface all too much. It's an enamel product, so we can clean it up with the odorless turpentine, but I don't want to mess it up, so I don't have to clean it. And with all the road wheels done and letting them dry for just a little bit, it's time to assemble the whole thing and do the cleanup I mentioned before. The unaffected area for the pigments will be covered with the tracks without any problems. We will not see this again. And the windows we left are barely visible now. And with the tracks on, the area is shaded a little bit. So we are all fine from the perspective of composition or leaving the effects a little bit room to breathe in. I'm quite happy to put the tracks on now. They are rusty as hell and they are messy, but it's getting a step in the process a little bit more finished. I finish the tracks up with a little bit of a wet effect. That's an enamel product or an enamel binder. Pigments are not present, and this dries glossy, leaving the impression of a freshly wet surface. And with the tracks, I pick out only a few links, giving it a little bit of a stainy effect. And I think this comes quite nicely together here. As a last point, I did not hesitate to cover up the details on the road wheels, just because this is one vehicle in a collection of Porsche Taycan tanks, and so the detail is present on my other vehicles. There's no problem here in this case. My references are showing this vehicle with a wooden recovery beam attached to the motor deck, so I would like to replicate this by using a piece of wood. It's slightly out of scale, I have to admit, but that's the only one I could get my hands on, so I use this for now. I washed it in a neutral gray wash and added some streaks and grain effects with the very same wash I use for the complete vehicle. That's a brown wash for German dark yellow, I think. The jack was weathered and prepared the same way than the rest of the vehicle. A wash, this brown wash for German dark yellow, applied over it in all recesses, and then it was chipped by using a brighter version of the German dark yellow, followed by a dark brown chipping color. The one thing I do differently in this variant is I use a third chipping color. I think these tools were used quite often and harshly, so I add a third layer of chipping using a black metal color. Same goes for the grain, that one is folded up, and I start here with the dry brushing of this very same black metal color, just to give it an impression of a previously hard used tool or accessory to the tank. Dry brushing is not the best technique for a 1/35 scale model, belongs more into Warhammer, or maybe it functions better in a smaller scale, but yeah, you get away with it every now and then, and it's a quite fast technique. So now I'm reversing the chipping process, framing the whole thing with my bright color and coming back with the dark one to inlay the previously outlined metal color. Best part of a build process or weathering process is putting all of the things together. The tank starts to look like a tank, we get a little bit more life into it, and yeah, that's just the favorite part. The kit comes with very good accessories. We get towing cables, we get small chains for the hoist mechanism, and it would be a shame if we don't put them on display, even though they would be stored inside the vehicle on the real thing. Looking through my stash, I was able to find some resin casted MG barrels. I will put a gun on this one, just to give it a little bit more interest, putting more things onto it, make it a little bit more crowded. And I found a brass 2-meter antenna I added on the rear of the vehicle with all the accessories attached. It's finally time to put the weathering together by adding some mud splashes, and I covered doing this in very good detail in my Panzer 1 Ausführung B video. I will not repeat the whole process here this time. I just use three different paints out of the splash ranges from Ammo by MIG and apply them, pull them down, reapply them until I get a layering of these textures. Best thing, the whole kit is now finished. It is off my desk and finally joined his colleagues in my collection of Porsche Taycan tanks. I'm finished with this one for now, so nothing more to say than happy modeling to you guys. Thank you so much for watching, and see you next week.